Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Daily Volatility Box Report for November 5th, 2019. We are TOSindicators.com, home of the Volatility Box. Once again, we had another day of low volatility in the markets, evident by no entries in the markets that we actually look at. And so today, we'll spend some time looking at the copper futures, since the copper futures did actually offer us entries. And we'll talk about just another indicator that you may start to want to layer on if you find that it's useful if you're looking to trade the copper futures. And then we'll also talk about an entry using our stock volatility box in STNE. Before we get into charts, let's take a look at what's on the calendar for tomorrow. So we have an FOMC member speaking. Really, I don't expect this to cause too much volatility in the markets. We also see that it has a yellow folder. So objectively, we can just use that to help us determine that we expect this, and then FOMC member Evan speaking, to be relatively low volatility events. The thing that I do think may move, may be interesting rather to trade is the crude oil inventories. And so this trade has worked out really well for us in recent history, at least on crude. We've only lost one time, I believe, in the past four, five, six reports, something like that, where we're waiting for crude inventories to come out. But before that, we used the volatility starting 4 a.m. Pacific onwards to help us determine which volatility box to use. And so that then not only helps you get into playing the report with a little bit more preparation. So in case you've already seen some volatility ahead of time, we can be ready to go with our conservative volatility box. And if we've really seen some muted price action, then you have permission rather to use the aggressive volatility box. And then once the results come out, we also look to see what happened compared to the comparisons. So we've seen that so far we've really had a lot of surplus in crude oil. We've seen that stockpiles are starting to increase. That's been sort of the news story so far. And so I think it'll be interesting to see what the actual number is in comparison to that news story. We've also seen that crude has just continued to keep going up. And I believe it also gapped up yesterday. And so that's something interesting to keep an eye out for. But really, the 4 a.m. test is what you can use to try and play the crude inventories report. We'll start with our copper futures first. And so here we have our aggressive volatility box plotted. And now let's approach this market as if it was a normal market that we were trading with our normal rule set. According to that, we would have drawn that first hour test at 6 a.m., so that first full hour after the market opens, and we would have then checked to see whether or not we breached either side's aggressive volatility box. Here, we very clearly did, which would have then been your sign to switch on over to the conservative volatility box, especially after seeing that we didn't get a move in the opposite direction, but instead ended up continuing to blow past the clouds, right? And so typically, this would have then been your sign to switch on over to the conservative volatility box. And if we go ahead and do that, what we'll find is that there were no entries for the rest of the day in the copper futures. Now, I'll show you something which I think is sort of interesting, and this is using that dynamic RSI indicator. And Keith made some updates, including adding some colored candles to the upper study. Right? And so let's take a look once again at the aggressive volatility box, but this time with our colored candles layered on. And so all of a sudden, our charts become a little bit more of a canvas. And if we used a 5-minute chart, just our normal time frame that we use, and this is where I will acknowledge that I think a different time frame will start to give you different information. And so again, this is just because we're observing the market that we're making note of this, but we see in that first entry, we didn't really get any sort of transition. We continued to have green candles throughout almost. And as we hit our volatility box, we didn't really see a transition from green to orange or yellow or red. However, now we see the second time we hit our aggressive volatility box, we did see a transition from green to orange. Then when we hit our volatility box again, giving us our long entry, we transitioned from red to orange, sort of giving you that almost confidence, if you will, that it may be okay to start to look at this as an aggressive entry, despite our rules having gotten us out in this first entry if you were looking to be a more aggressive trader. And if we apply the same sort of concept, but now let's bring it to gold, which is our other market where we are have limited hours that we're looking to trade. Using gold, this would have been that first breach of the aggressive volatility box using our first hour test. We didn't really make that opposite thrust move, and that would have then been your sign to switch on over to the conservative volatility box. And so now in the case of gold, if we switch on over to the conservative volatility box, What we'll notice is we didn't really have any other entries for the rest of the day, but if we came back to the aggressive volatility box and we'll bring back in that study, then we'll notice that if you were trying to then break the rules and look for a little bit more aggressive of an entry, then this would have been the next spot that you're looking at where you only had a small follow through, but you didn't really make what we would have been risking here, right? And so for the cases of us, this would have been a stop out actually in this wick candle right here. And we're really only looking at gold between 6 to 7 a.m. So that's why this wasn't a valid entry. But now to play sort of devil's advocate to the whole point of using the colored indicators, this is also a time where it didn't work. And so it's important to keep in mind the probabilities. But again, I think Keats' new version of this dynamic RSI starts to give you an idea on how you may more aggressively trade, or at least trade a little bit more often if that better fits your trading style. A lot of our members, we've heard you say plenty of times that you want more opportunities than less, and maybe that fits your trading style a little bit more. Personally, I like to have fewer signals, but more accurate signals. But now if you are looking for a longer trend, then you may start to use something like this, maybe even on a 1 minute chart, which we'll show you on Stone, which was our next entry, our stock volatility box entry. But we'll show you how using this on Stone helped give you almost a picture perfect trade. Right. And so using our stock volatility box, if we bring that in and we load it in. And so we ran this off of our volatilitybox.com website. And this is that same indicator that we got. These levels were plotted as of our high right at the open. And we were ready to go with our order parked right here. Right. And so this is our normal volatility box trade. No information. Our entry is right here at the beginning of the clouds. Our stop is outside of the volatility box. And our first target is the dashed line. And this trade worked picture perfect. Now, let's go ahead and layer in that dynamic RSI just to show you how if, say, you wanted multiple confirmations, then you may actually be looking at something like this. And we'll come to a one-day, one-minute chart since we're looking at day trading this. As soon as price slammed into our volatility box entry lines, what would have been our entry, this is really where we would have normally been filled. And we can see on a one-minute candle, this transition from red to green, which would then really be your sort of check mark validating this trade, letting you know that it's okay to enter. Right? And our ideal place of entry is, again, the beginning of the clouds, looking for a target of 80 cents in this case. And so just to then give you numbers, because I think some of you like to talk options, some of you like stock. So this move right here on a $35 stock represented about 80 cents. And that's what we were looking for, risking about 80 cents to make 80 cents using the stock. And on previous videos, I've talked about the benefits of using stock. But now for those of you that like to trade options, the at-the-money options right here, as soon as price slammed into the volatility box, we're trading for about $1.10 to $1.15 in terms of the bid-ask spread. And as we hit our targets, they were trading for closer to $1.55 to $1.60. And I think that starts to give you an idea of how you may even use something like leverage use options to trade a move like this. If you're looking to try and have leverage in your favor and you don't necessarily care about having perfection, whereas in our case, right, I like to have very concrete price levels that I can start to just take off. So in theory, I can step away from the computer if I wanted and my orders are in place. If, say, you happen to be actually monitoring this trade, or you happen to be an active options trader where you really like to control this, or you've built a really nice option spread, something that really helps you reduce the risk, then all of a sudden you can see that these gains happen almost instantly, right? That $1.15 to $1.55, $1.60 move happened really over the course of about 40, 45 minutes. Right? And that's a nice gain for 45 minutes worth of work, in which most of this was automated. Right, our scans alerted us that Stone was an entry. Our volatility box then did all of the heavy lifting in terms of plotting these levels. And all we had to do was come in and just be order takers, put in our order, just be emotionless, follow our trade plan, and look to see whether we hit our target or our stop. Hopefully tonight's video helped you. And for those of you using the stock volatility box, we're going to be testing that dynamic RSI a little bit more, and then we might release it on the actual volatilitybox.com website, but we'll be sure to send you a link once we've tested it to make sure we've ironed out any of the last bugs in it before we hand it out for all of you to start using in your trading. All right, so just keep an eye out tomorrow for that crude inventories report. For those of you who like to trade crude, I think this is going to be a fun trade. It's usually worked out pretty well for us, and so hopefully that should change the course of this low volatility environment that we've been seeing for the past few days. Take care, everyone, and we'll see you in tomorrow's nightly update.